When there are issues to talk about, we talk about them. When there are matters to debate, we create the platform. When there are tough national decisions to make, we bring the stakeholders. All Things Considered, a television talk show designed to bring all that matters right to your television set. Never miss the conversation this and every Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 7:50 p.m. on The Nation's Pride, the Liberia National Television, LNTV, with your host, Daniel Ankrah. All Things Considered, creating the platform for an inclusive dialogue.
Well, it's a pleasant good evening to all of you. Welcome to The Nation's Pride. This is the Liberia National Television, and I'm Daniel Ankrah. Welcome to the program, All Things Considered. This is a program that comes away every Monday and Wednesday evening. That's from 7 to 7:50 p.m. This program brings to you all things that matter. That's why we call it All Things Considered. Well, today we're not going to be shouting, talking about politics, but we're going to be talking about development today. And to do that and to help us share in the development drive of this government, we have invited and we have the privilege of introducing at this point in time on our program. He's Dr. Clarence Moniba. He's the head of the President Delivery Unit in the Office of the President. Dr. Moniba, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm happy to be here. And let's talk about all things that matters and consider.
Right? Yeah, sure. Well, thank you very much for joining us. And it's going to be a wonderful conversation, trust me. Now, many of us know that, this government has got about 6 months or more, put in 150 days, put in 200 days, put in 300 days, however you put it. But the tenure of this government comes to an end by January, technically by October, November, but January officially, when this president will turn over to another president. Who that will be left with the politicians. But today we're here to talk about what the government has to do within the last period. And it's called the last mile. As you may have heard in the news, you're listening to news outlets, the cabinet held a retreat recently in Jilidua, Bomi County, on the president's farm. Well, he will tell us the intent of that retreat, and we're hearing something called the last mile. What is that? We'll be finding out from him right now. Well, Dr. Moniba, welcome once again. And I'm concerned about this cabinet retreat. Some people see it as the government is rushing now to do plenty of development so that they can say they have done something. Right.
No, and what I've always been trying to explain to people is that the intent isn't to say, oh, we're rushing to do something so because we want to act like we're working. Mm. We actually are working. And the 150-day plan that we have is something that has been in the process for years.
Okay.
You see? So, for example, if we were to talk about ports, which I know we'll get into the details a little bit later.
Sure.
But, one of the deliverables we have is the fact that we are going to, we have the terminal building being built right now. So this isn't something 2 years ago, 2015, we went to China to negotiate the deal, to find contractors, to be able to come negotiate the deal and mobilize in country. So this has been a 2 year process. So all we're saying that in the next 150 days, where are we gonna be? So we've broken up the 150 days into three categories. Things, projects that we'll complete, projects that we plan to start, and projects that we plan to finalize funding for. As we know, government, the country doesn't finish when this government ends.
Sure.
So what we want to be able to do, at the very least, if we can't complete it, if we can't start it, the next government can come and we can give them a feasibility study. We can give them the bank account and say, the money has been secured, the feasibility is here, you can get started immediately. So then the next government doesn't have to take the time to go look for funders, to go look for people to help them put the project together.
That's quite interesting, but why a cabinet retreat, to get everybody back on their feet? Well, I mean, that's ending the last mile.
No, honestly, we have the cabinet retreat. The cabinet retreat itself is done once a year.
Okay.
So every single year, we get everybody together. So we're talking about from, of course, the president and the vice president, but we're talking about the ministers, the deputy ministers, the assistant ministers, you know, we're talking about all the heads of agencies and the deputy directors, the deputy managing directors. Because the idea is that the president, at the very least, all of us are busy. You know, all of us have our days where we work 10, 12-hour days every single day. So at least for 1 or 2 days, you know, all of us, the entire government can get together, you know, can network, can just show face to each other. And then, you know, everybody can get on the same page. The people in water and sewer may not necessarily know what we're doing in electricity. The same thing for roads, the same thing for ports, the same thing for education. So the idea is that everybody, we stand in front of each other and we tell each other as a government, as one unit, what we're doing. So that's kind of the whole idea about the cabinet retreat.
So going through the cabinet retreat, when the president opened the cabinet retreat, she talked about collaboration amongst, you know, heads of agencies, ministers and all of that. And she mentioned something that I'm going to mention to you. She said that when Minister A goes to see Minister B, Minister B stays in his office and say, and tell his secretary to tell him to wait, whereas they know that they got major projects going. You know, the relationship between government ministers. I mean, is that a problem? Is that something the president has identified?
No, and honestly, you have to be cautious.
Okay.
You know, especially when you have very limited days left, you have to be able to, and she's our captain. She's telling us, you know, she gives us the path we have to move forward. So all she was doing, similar to what a parent would tell their child, be careful. And, you know, that's something she doesn't want to do. You know, my job as, you know, her deputy chief of staff and the head of the president's delivery unit is to make sure that all the coordination between the ministers happen. And, you know, me personally, I speak to almost every single minister almost every single day. And, you know, fortunately, nobody is like that. Everybody is focused on delivering for the Liberian people. So to be honest with you, I think what she was doing was trying to caution us as, you know, we enter this last mile, because we have specific tangible things that we want to be able to deliver to the Liberian people. So those are some of the cautions she was just trying to make sure that we face in terms of if somebody goes to see you, you know, make sure that, you know, we facilitate each other just to make sure that we can deliver to the Liberian people what we're promising in this 150 days.
So Liberia is moving now from the extractive sector to agriculture, and that seems to be topping the agenda when it comes to, because looking at the economy, looking at revenue generation base, you know, it's leaning down on the extractive sector now. It's moving to somewhere else. So let's get to the specifics and begin with agriculture.
Okay, just to quickly elaborate a little bit on what you're saying, you know, because we have to diversify as an economy, You know, everybody talks about, oh, the rate is going up. It's simply because we don't have enough exports coming in. We're importing too much. So we have to start to look at other things as opposed to just shipping our raw iron ore, shipping our raw rubber. You know, we have to start to look at other things. Now, it's a long process that we have to put in place. But when we look at the agriculture sector, which, you know, gives us the potential for some of the biggest growth.
Okay.
You know, we talked about in rice. You know, what are we going to do in rice? Right now, we import estimated about $200 million. Is anywhere, estimates are broad, but from anywhere from $120 million to $200 million of U.S. dollars that we have to export to bring rice in the country. So we've been looking at the plan again for several months. This isn't something that just come up, but we've looked at it and we said that we're going to operationalize 4 rice mills in Lofa, 2 in Lofa and 2 in Nimba, to be able to start to process rice in the country. So then we can start to cut down on some of our imports of rice. You know, and this also helps the economy itself. We start to become more self-sufficient, you know, and then we also don't have to import as much rice, which is a staple food in our country.
So in terms of the agri sector, you just talk about rice. But what's with the farmers too? Empowering farmers across the country, you know, putting them into units through which they can be able to do a lot more than just subsistence farming.
Right. No, I mean, you're absolutely right. So the first step we've had to do is to identify all of the farmers that we have in the country. So, you know, with some partners and everybody else, we've been able to identify 300,000 plus farmers. You know, of course, we're talking
in Liberia
about
currently?
In Liberia, you're talking about different, you know, somebody might be farming just in the backyard. They say they're a farmer. But, you know, we've been able to register that many people and then also identify what they're growing, you know, what their main focus is. So then from there, at least now we have a strategic understanding of the kind of crops we can potentially grow in Liberia. So when you talk about, you know, making, putting farmers in clusters, for example. Mm. If we go to one of the other 150 deliverables that we talked about, it's about the cassava. We want to start to process cassava as well. And the idea about that is that we're going to focus in seven different counties: Bumi, Bong, Grand Bassa, Magibi, Monterado, Sino, and Nimba. These are the seven counties we're going to put these eight different clusters in cassava processing.
Okay.
So the idea about that is that different places, we're going to have 1,000 cassava growing farmers support this one place. So okay. Once we can do that, you know, then these people start to, then we start to produce at volume. And that's the key right now. Right now, a lot of our farmers are doing stuff, but it's not on scale to say that we want to be able to, we will be able to export. It's not on scale to say that we can start becoming commercial. So that's the next iteration, and that's the next step that we have to take as a country. Our farmers have to get a little bit better cooperating, working together, making these bigger, you know, bigger farms so that we can start to produce massively. But again, I talked about operationalizing rice, you know, in terms of rice mills, four rice mills. Same thing with cassava as well. You know, if we can establish these eight places in the next 150 days, then at that point we start talking about producing and processing cassava. So that's what we really have to focus on there.
Okay, so now that's for agriculture on that point. Let's talk a bit about education. The education system, some work have been done, but there's been a lot of challenge in the education system. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, what is the plan? Because education is not like, okay, let's go build a road. It will take us 6 months to build a road. So you can say it will take us 6 months to educate other people. So, I mean, what's in the plan for education?
Okay, so when we look at education, what we decided and what what we know we have to do is that, you know, the minister has been working on policies, you know. When we look at education in Liberia, we also have to look at teacher training. You know, teacher training has been an issue for us.
Okay.
And it's not just because, you know, we don't have smart teachers or we don't have committed teachers. It's because the foundation of a lot of the teachers that we have right now, again, nobody wants to continue to talk about the war. But 14 years, we didn't have, you know, regular schooling, proper equipment. So these people who came up through the system are now teachers. You know, if there's a war, you're only going to school 1 or 2 days a week. You're not getting the true foundation that we really need. So the idea about teacher training right now is something, the issue that we as a country, we're going to have to deal with that for, honestly, the next generation. We're going to have to continue to build the capacity of our teachers. So when we look at this next 150-day plan, the idea and the issue with this plan is that, okay, what can we do, tangible results, to be able to show the Liberian people? So, of course, you can't say, oh, this teacher is smarter now in the next 150 days.
Sure, sure.
So what we're trying to do is to focus on watch facilities. You know, we know our children are in school. We know that the enrollment, you know, have increased from well under a million to over a million and a half, 1.7 million students in Liberia, well over that. So the idea is that now all of these students are in classrooms that are overcrowded. We already faced what we had to face during 2014 about the Ebola, 2014, 2015. So as the government, as we transition out, we have to make sure that we have the facilities for our students. So we've decided in the 150-day plan to identify five different counties where we're going to build 120 schools in five different counties. We're going to build wash facilities for them to make sure that they have, you know, water, sanitation, hygiene is addressed. You know, again, as we go back to training teachers, capacity building, we also have to focus on the infrastructure. That's what this 120.
I'm concerned. Why focus on WASH in about 120 schools? Why WASH?
Well, because, you know, again, you have overcrowded schools. So when we talk about the WASH in 120 schools in the five different counties, in Monrovia itself, we've also identified 10 schools. You know, and we're still finalizing the actual list. You know, but in Kinshasa, every school that has over 1,000 students enrolled, we're going to be building WASH facilities and classrooms as well in this plan. So these are strong, tangible things that people will be able to see. You know, so it's just not, oh, we said it and it's not happening. At the end of the 150 days, people will be able to see that the work is actually going on. But again, it's WASH facilities, it's infrastructure, because as I said, the enrollment of our schools has increased dramatically. You know, you go in the typical classroom now, you have dozens of students, you know, maybe sitting on one bench when it should be five or six students. So we have to be able to address that as we address teacher training, teacher capacity.
Okay, now that's on education. I'm concerned Let's talk a bit about energy, power generation. That is that is topical. I mean, it's remained topical for a long time because we have, how many turbines we have on now? Three?
We have two turbines. Luckily for us, on Wednesday, we'll be turning on the third turbine.
You mean this Wednesday?
Yes, this Wednesday. Okay. The Crown Prince of Norway is in country, and on Wednesday, we'll be taking him up to Mount Coffee. So that we can, you know, of course, Norway is a good friend of ours, of the country. They've been with us, especially in the power sector for us. They've helped to fund a lot of projects we're having. And so the Crown Prince is in country. And so we're going to be dedicating a third turbine, which in itself is 22 megawatts as well. So right now we have 2 megawatts that's operational. It's working. Each one is 22 megawatts. So that's 44 megawatts in totality. We're going to do the third one, which is going to give us 66 megawatts. And by June, latest July, we'll have the fourth turbine on, an additional 22 megawatts, which is 88 total megawatts.
I'm concerned. You're heading the President Delivery Unit. Mm-hmm. And how does the President get feedback as to these plans as they've been implemented? And I'm asking because, take for example, power generation. Mm-hmm. You have power outages in the city. People complain. They complain here, there, about talk shows and all of that. Mm-hmm. So, does the President get the feedback, and normally how does she receive the feedback and what does she do after it?
Okay, so the first thing, if she doesn't get the feedback, that means I'm not doing my job. So, because, you know, the whole idea and concept of the President Delivery Unit, the PDU, is that every single day, you know, I have a strong team, I have a very good team who surrounds me. And so I have about 20 people who focus on all the various sectors that we're talking about, roads, ports, energy, education, agriculture, health, the likes. So all of them, their job daily is to be with the ministers, is to be with the deputy ministers, and to be with the contractors. So they have an instant pulse on what's going on firsthand. Their job is to find out immediately, work out the solutions with the ministers, and also brief me on a daily basis. To call a meeting for me so I go and sit down with the ministers and strategize. Then my job, after all of that is done throughout the entire day, about 8, 8:30, besides today because you asked me to come here. But normally every single day, about 8 to 8:30, I go in there and have a one-on-one with the president. And I literally go down every single thing that's going on in terms of priority projects. You know, so the turbine, for example, I will give her the strategy. She'll provide guidance. If she wants, she calls the minister and, of course, who is the sector head. You know, we all sit down around the table. So, I mean, the president is as detailed and hands-on as possible because, you know, there's a thousand different things coming up. There's a thousand different things she has to be briefed on, and there's a thousand things she has to make decisions on. And so every single night I have to sit with her and go through all of these things, you know, and so that's why I have to have a good team. I myself have to be good to be able to give her the facts and for her to make the decision, the final decision. We move forward.
Currently, what's going on with energy? I mean, in terms of distribution, connections, and all of that, because it seems that, yes, we're now generating the power, but the power is not reaching to the people. It's difficult to get LEC, to get meter, the list is endless.
No, I mean, it's endless, but we're working at it, you know. And so the idea about the generation of power is that in 2015, we maybe had 15 megawatts, and that was very shaky. You know, for anybody who is connected to the grid right now, they understand that when they connected to LEC, you know, they're going days, if not weeks, without disconnections. Of course, right now, there's some issues here and there. But in 2015, we have 15 total megawatts, and that was based on diesel generators. So very, very shaky. So since 2015 to now, we've have commissioned 38 megawatts of HFO, heavy fuel generators, which are meant to run 24/7 nonstop. These are long-term 15, 20-year generators that run. They're giving us a total of 38 megawatts. You also have to realize that because we haven't connected as many people as we need to, we only at peak we have between 19 to 22 megawatts. So right now we have enough power. We have to focus on connections. In addition to that, we have Mount Coffee coming online. So essentially by July, we're going to have 126 megawatts of power on. But as you rightly said, we have to connect people. So LEC, you know, we have a new management team at LEC that's been doing a tremendous job, a very good job in terms of connecting homes and being more responsive to the people. We also have a lot of donors and partners. And, you know, a lot of the work that the president does, that her ministers do, is trying to liaise and talk to partners to be able to generate funding. You know, because as you know, the generation is one thing, but the transmission and distribution, the connections, is extremely expensive. So we have to be able to focus on that too. So the idea is that we have four major corridors that's going on in and outside. So the first corridor I'll talk about is Monrovia Consolidated. This is a grant by the European Union. We're talking about 50 million euros that was given to the to our country. We have to connect homes with that. Right now, the hope is that by the 7th, which is I think Thursday or Friday, we're going to be signing of April of this month. We're going to be signing the contract that will connect 38,000 homes from additional homes now from Mama Point all the way going towards Painesville. 38,000 homes. That will also provide us a redundancy, because right now in Liberia, we only have one kind of loop. So once one community goes down, you know, sometimes people say, oh, LEC is down. It's not necessarily that. You have a lot of the poles come down, the weather, then you say LEC is down. It still may be generating, but the thing is that we only have one major line right now that feeds the city. This Minerva Consolidation Corridor I'm talking about would not only connect 38,000 homes, small businesses, and large businesses, but it will also add a redundancy to what we have so that when parts of the city go down, it doesn't affect as many homes and businesses and everything else. So that's the first corridor. The second one is this Kakata Corridor, which is going to connect about, the contract stipulates that it connects 24,500 homes. That's an additional 24,000 homes. And that work is ongoing right now. If you drive from red light going towards Kakata, you will see the poles going up. You will see the lines going up. Like I said, that's going to connect a lot of 24,500.
Those are things people can see.
Exactly. And so when we talked about the 150, we wanted to identify things that people can see. So the idea with that, we've sat with the Minister of Landmines and Energy. We've sat with LEC. We've been doing a lot of negotiations. The goal for this is that by October, all of the connections will be done. If you look at the average, we're talking about 4,000 plus connections on that stretch, red light to Kakata, within the next 4 to 5 months. You know, so again, something people can see, something people can feel. So that's the second corridor. The third corridor is the Bumi Corridor. That's gonna connect, give or take 36,000 or so. Okay. 36,000 homes, 36,000 small businesses. The thing with that right now is that we've secured the funding from the World Bank, upwards of $60 million to do that entire stretch of road. So now what we have to do with that is we're doing the wrap payments right now because, you know, people, you can't really necessarily live under the lines or whatever. Sure. So the work's going on in terms of the wrap study.
With all of these connections coming online, does it in any way suggest to us, the cost of electricity will decrease?
Of course, that's the goal. You know, our goal before we leave is to drop electricity again. Initially, we all know that it was 54 cents. It went down to 49 cents during the president's annual message. And, you know, she discussed it with the team. She got advice. She was able to give the directive and order to be able to drop it to 39 cents, you know. And so for people who have LEC, it makes a huge, it was a 20% drop from 49 to 39 cents. So the idea is that the more connections we have, the better we become in terms of our liquid costs, and we can drop costs down. And so these are the connections that we're trying to make the system more efficient, to be able to drop electricity. Also, costs will come down because now we're using hydro. You know, we're using the HFO. We're using HFO, which is a little bit more expensive, but at least we have it. We're also using the hydro, Mount Coffee Hydro. You know, so that will immediately start to bring down the cost of all these things. So in the next 4, 5, 6 months, we can look at it again and try to bring the cost down. I do want to mention, though, corridor is the ERW junction towards RIA. Okay. That would connect approximately 13,000 additional homes. This is something that we were able to negotiate a loan from the AFDB, African Development Bank, for $42 million. It also includes not only the connections, but we're also talking about capacity building as well. For Liberians, because now we cannot be sustainable if we keep importing people to do our work, our electrical work. Mm-hmm. So we have to start to train Liberians to be able to do the work. And so that's a focus also, as we try to connect all these homes, You know, as we try to expand the network, we have to be able to train Liberians to do the work.
Sure.
So last thing in energy, I know you,
yeah, sure.
But the last thing in energy, if we can do all of the connections that we're talking about, we're talking by October, the hope is that we would have done approximately 55,000 new connections, you know? And so when we talk about the 150-day plan, we're talking about real tangible things that people can see, people can feel. 50,000 plus connections in the next 6 months, that's something that the Liberian people will be able to see and appreciate.
Okay, well, if you just joined us, this is a reminder that you're watching Ellen TV, and the program you're watching is called All Things Considered. It comes away Monday and Wednesday evening from 7 to 7:50 p.m. We're going to run for a short break now, because when we come back, then we shift to roads and health, and you just name it. An hour is just not enough to talk about all of these things. But sure, my guest is Dr. Clarence Moniba. He's the head of the President Delivery Unit in the Office of the President, making sure that the last time remaining is used very wisely and tangible, as you can see. Like he said, one thing I like to say quickly, these are things that are being completed, things that are starting, and things that they're securing funding for. When we come back from the break, as usual, we take text messages and calls and also WhatsApp messages. So the WhatsApp message number is 0770-382-262. 0770-382-262. And the number to call is 0886-948471. 0886-948471. You can send a WhatsApp message to any of these numbers, as well as send text messages and also post through your calls. We'll take them when we come back from the break. Stay tuned.
When there are issues to talk about, we talk about them. When there are matters to debate, we create the platform. When there are tough national decisions to make, we bring the stakeholders. All Things Considered, a television talk show designed to bring all that matters right to your television set. Never miss the conversation this and every Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 7:50 p.m. on The Nation's Pride, the Liberia National Television, Ellen TV, with your host, Daniel Ankrah. All Things Considered, creating the platform for an inclusive dialogue.
Okay, welcome back. Creating the platform for an inclusive dialogue. We certainly give you a chance to ask him. You can ask him anything you want to ask him regarding what this government will do, or something you think he's not talking about. What has this government got to do? What has this president got to do about things until she leaves office in January? Well, you can ask him that. The number is to do so, 0886-948471, the area on your screen. Or 0770-382-262. Send a WhatsApp message to any of these numbers, as well as text messages and calls, and we'll read them and take them as we go through. Okay, we're not taking it right now. So let's talk about roads. And I like to say that we should begin from the southeast, because that part of the country gets caught up every year, and we're approaching the rainy season. Mm-hmm. I know it doesn't take 2-3 months to build, you know, entire stretch of road, but I know there are other road works, and the president recently broke grounds for road in Fishtown.
Yeah, from Caloocan to Fishtown.
Yeah, so let's talk about the southeast to begin with.
Okay, no problem. So, you know, again, the idea is that, and what we have been able to do, especially the current Minister of Public Works, you know, he's really been able to for us,
yeah,
you know, he's been able to identify and try to lay out the map of the entire country, how we can connect all of the various county capitals, all of the major roads. So what Minister Moore has been able to do now is, and what the president, you know, had been pushing for, is that even if we don't finish the road, even if we don't start the road, the new government will come and be able to have a feasibility study ready for funding. You know, because a lot of people don't understand. A feasibility study takes years to complete. Years. And it's very cost intensive.
No matter what,
millions.
What is being studied during the feasibility study?
Okay. Doing
just
is
briefly, yeah.
Just briefly. Okay, so in a feasibility, what you're doing is, how you want to build the road, where the road have to go. You also have to do a lot of soil testing as well. You know, so then you have to do taking into concern wrap implications. And so everything is in terms of how the road is going to be built technically to socially, you have to take in the social impact as well. So you have to consider all these different things, and then you have to design the road. And then that also has to go for a redesign and verification. So we're talking about a lot of steps, processes, and cost. So, you know, when people say, oh, they need to build this road, there's several steps before you even go look for funding from any funder, from any bank. They're going to ask, where's the feasibility study? The feasibility study for a typical road runs in the millions. So you have to source that money. Then you have to do the procurement to do the feasibility study. So by the time you even start doing the feasibility study, it's a year plus. By the time you complete the feasibility study, you're talking about 2-3 years in the entire process. You know, so people also need to understand this when they say, oh, government needs to build this road. So what we have been able to do as a government is, if we haven't started the road, at least have the feasibility study ready. So the new government will be able to come and in a turnover notes, and here is what we're doing right now, is we're doing the feasibility study from Ganta to Zwedru. Okay? So the cost of that is about $300 million to do. Of course, we can't
half
do
of the national
half budget. Of the national budget. Then before you go to Banga, all the way to Minicoma, that's another $300 million. So just to do those two roads, that's the entire budget. So that means if you do those two roads, you're not paying anybody, you're not doing anything. You know, so it's very cost intensive. So that's why I like when people just sit there and say, oh, if I'm president or if my party, I'll build this road, I'll build this. They're not understanding that, you know, this thing is kukujumuku, and you're not inside, you don't know.
You don't know.
You know. So people have to really understand the difficulties of this. So I just say all that to mean, this government at least will be able to hand to the new government a feasibility study completed from Ganta to Zwedru. Okay? All the way really to Fishtown, I'm sorry, from Ganta to Fishtown. And then they will meet an ongoing paved road from Fishtown down to Harper. They're going to see a feasibility study that's ready from Banga all the way to Minicoma. They're going to see the actual work being done from Banga all the way to Salaye. So, you know, these are things that we're doing. So when you go to the southeast, yes, we're doing Fishtown to Harper right now.
Harper,
well, yeah, Kalokin is first phase, and then from there to Fishtown is the second phase. So it's two different contractors, but they're working simultaneously. And the work's going on. So there's work going on in the southeast in terms of that. And like I said, we'll have the feasibility studies going from Fishtown to Zwedru on towards Tapeta and then Ganta.
Okay, moving, if you text in, just do me a favor. If you text in on the program, just include your name and where you text in from. I mean, it gives us a fair understanding of, like I said, always how far you go, how far you reaching, the amount of people you reaching. It also gives us a fair understanding of that. I come to reading text messages now, but I see a lot of work going on in Sinkor, avenues and all of that, right, and rehabilitating roads and making sure that these roads are possible.
Right. Yeah. I mean, again,
all part of the last mile.
That's not necessarily part of the last mile, okay, because you know these Sinkor roads. You know, Ministry of Public Works kind of got on this thing because of, you know, he's trying to lay out Sinkor as we try to broaden it out and do the alleys, and you know, because there's a lot of construction, there's a lot of homes that way. So, you know, just to make our neighborhoods more accessible, our communities more accessible to our people. So, but that's not necessarily part of the last mile in terms of roads. You know, that's just something that goes into the regular work. So the 150 day things are things that the president has identified to say, I definitely will do this. Mm-hmm. But in addition to that, is a total of 37-38 projects in the 150-day plan. But every ministry still has their various projects going on. These are ones that directly from the president's office we are going to be following that falls in this 37-38 projects. And I keep saying 37-38 projects because people keep trying to add additional ones. Okay. Even today, you know, the president was talking about adding one or two more in this 150-day plan.
Good evening, Mr. Ankrah. I'm Joseph Ebenezer from Bandersville. Can your guest clearly state how many jobs the president has created? Because we know how many jobs the government promised.
Well, honestly, that's a very good question, to be honest with you. But I don't have the facilities to be able to answer that in terms of exact jobs. What I do know is that Liberia, what we have, I think 35,000 people working for the government. If I'm not mistaken,
that I knew that over 30,000.
Yeah, that's civil servants. That's too much. That's too much. We have to be able to facilitate and work on the private sector. The private sector must be the one doing these jobs. In reality, government is just there to regulate the laws and make sure things are done. People are law-abiding and abide by the laws. You know, that's what government should be doing. So I don't know what the number government this government has created in totality, to be honest with you, but I do know we have to continue to facilitate the private sector so they can create jobs and not necessarily the government. The government has to scale down on jobs as they facilitate the private sector to be able to increase jobs.
Okay, so I'm ready to take your calls now. 0886-948-471 and your messages 0770-382-262. My name is Abu S. Yama, texting from MVTC community. My question is, Somala Drive Road, will it be a four-lane road?
Yes, it will be. And so this is something when you talk about, you know, this government leaving something for the next government. Okay. So the first two lanes are what is what's being done right now, why people, you know, why everybody use that two lanes. So this work, the hope is that this will be completed by December of 2017, early 2018. Okay. Once that's completed, then the traffic will move on the new road. Mm-hmm. And then the president has already negotiated, the Minister of Public Works, the Minister of Finance, we've already negotiated the funding package for the other two lanes. So we're going to have a completed four-lane highway, two going, two coming. Once the two is finished, Double Bridge, Stockton Bridge, all those places, once those two are finished,
okay,
the work is going to end.
Hello, good evening.
Next one.
You say you got how many concerns? Three?
Yeah, I have three concerns.
So that, I only going to answer one.
Go ahead.
Every
government agency
you have, every
response unit.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Up to now, since I was here, I've been almost there. And 9 months, I have paid for everything I have online here. But up to now, my video has, I have a problem. I've been going at the office. There's no way I can get it back. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. This is why sometimes people talk about it.
Okay, I know that way you're going. So let's get to the next concern, because you're not the only person in life.
The next concern is the agricultural era.
Yeah.
The education era.
Mm-hmm.
I think it is important, but one thing, last time you want to tell me, education in this country and a lot of people, a lot of people have our youth, our children to be educated. Because the first thing government schools have, schools that are actually proper in this school, they are legal, all the
Thank you very much. Hello, good evening. No. Move away from the radio, please. There you go. Sorry, but you have to. We have to let you go, because the last thing we want right now, feedback, you know. Maxwell Johnson is writing, when will the city of Brookville receive electricity? Is it a part of any of the corridors you were talking about?
Right now, and what's so funny is, we were literally talking about that. So I had a meeting with the, I was sitting down having a meeting with the chairman today and the managing director, and we were talking about possibly getting, because Brewerville, of course, is a huge community,
sure,
we have to be able to focus on. So the idea is that LEC itself is going to be focusing on 1,800 connections per month,
right,
you know, themselves,
yeah, yeah,
besides the corridors. So what we have to do with the chairman, with the managing director, is we're trying to focus on how we can, you know, get some connections to Brewerville area sooner than what we have right now, because right now we're still trying to find source and funding for that, but we do have to have that. Because just today, that was a discussion. Because, trust me, everybody's been asking us about that, the brew
sure,
area.
Okay. Hello? What's your name? Lower your television set, please. Please, please, lower your television set. Go ahead. Go ahead. What is your name? Hello? Yeah, the best thing you can do first is tell us your name, you know. Hello, hello? What is your name, sir? Where do you call from? Go ahead. Lower your television, please. Go ahead. Hello? Sir, if you can lower your television set, I have to drop you off the line. Yeah, you're going to do that now. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I understand his point. I understand your point. Yeah, I think I understand your point, sir. I understand your point. His point is, LEC will go to a particular community, mm-hmm. connect this house, jump over a few houses, connect another house, and then they leave, and then they don't come back. Right. So people tend to wonder,
The issue with that is, as we have been going forward in terms of trying to connect communities,
yeah.
you know, we only have a limited amount of resources. So for example, we can't say that we're gonna connect all the homes in ELWA mm-hmm. and forget about Depot Road. So ourselves now, we have to make the determination. Okay, we're going to connect 1,000 homes in ELWA area. We're mm-hmm. gonna connect 1,000 homes in Duper Road. We're gonna connect 1,000 homes in Red Light area. Mm-hmm. So, and that's kind of how it just works. You know, some people are lucky, unfortunately. Some people, because as we're trying to find the funding, we have to also expand it to the communities mm-hmm. and not use all the money in one community to connect every single home. So the idea is that we secure some funding for, let's say, 20,000 homes in 10 communities. So we somewhat have to pick and choose. As we're negotiating additional funding, looking, sourcing our own budget to find additional funding to come back and do those additional homes. So that's kind of what we do in terms of it. That's why you see some homes connected, some homes not connected. But yeah, we talked about power theft earlier.
Yeah.
That does lead to power theft. Because if you're sitting there and your friend connected to LEC,
LEC
and you're in darkness, of course, it's just human nature. You know, so we at the government have to do a little bit better job trying to expedite some of these connections so that, you know, people won't be, you know, like tempted to do power theft. Right now, as we speak, we have 33-34% of everything that we do is power theft, meaning for every dollar, 33% of it is going to power theft. So imagine if we can have that kind of money mm-hmm. to reinvest into the grid, to reinvest into connecting homes. So that's what we, so all of us have to work together.
Hello?
Yeah, hello.
Good evening, sir. What's your name?
My name is Prince, you're calling for the bill.
Go ahead, Prince.
Yeah, I really want to find out, I'm doing for a
bill.
I don't know what happened.
Okay. I mean, at some point in time, we'll have to either Wednesday or next week bring the LEC managing director here.
Yeah.
Hello, good evening.
Yeah, I'm calling for the LEC community.
Yeah, go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I'm concerned about the rules.
Okay, go ahead.
SKD Boulevard community.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello, good evening. Hello, good evening. Hello, Hello, good evening. Sorry. Once you give us that kind of feedback, we just can keep you on the line. This one says, hi, I am Charles Odell from, I'm texting from, let me just get that text message. So I'm Charles Odell, head of Liberia Association for Natural and Applied Sciences. It says, I want to know your plans on training us to replace the aged in the area of natural sciences. Should you got that wrong? Okay, let me take another one once you try to process that one down. This one says, let me get to this text message. This next text message is coming here. It says his name is Aaron Willie, and he's texting. He says, "My name and I'm texting from Pinesville 7 Circle. I really want to know when the road will be connected, because it's the gateway to our country. Which one of them is the gateway?
Which road?
Which one? No, he didn't. I mean, he didn't specify. I'm sure he didn't specify. You know, the road. But you want to address some of the other ones.
I mean, I don't even know where to start. So I know a lot of people are calling for LEC services.
LEC road and
all. LEC, yeah. So the management team, the new management team that took over, you know, and I said it earlier, you know, it's a very young, dynamic Liberian team, you know, voted. Fode has been doing an excellent job getting his team and everybody else to do work, you know, to be more responsive to the Liberian people. You know, and I made this example to cabinet last week during my presentation. The average of connections were 300 maybe per month before this new team took over.
Okay.
They're looking at, in 1 month, they were able to do 3,000 connections. In one single day, they were able to do 580 plus connections. You know, so this new team is more responsive. So all I can say is please be patient with the new team. They're good, they're young, they're dynamic, they're Liberian. They want to prove themselves, you know? And so all I can say is be patient. If, you know, if the individual problems, I know they have been able to clear a lot of the backlog. You know, when they met there, I think, like I said, they had 2,000 backlog. They're addressing that. You know, so unfortunately, you're one of the 2,000. But fortunately, we now have a team, hopefully, that will be able to address your issues, you know, sooner rather than later. In terms of, somebody talked about the rate, so I'm going to jump around a little bit.
Yeah,
you know, why is the rate going up? I said it before, we have to diversify ourselves. The reason why the rate was lower that time is because the export that we had was rubber, was iron ore. They were at highs at that time. The iron ore price dropped over half. The rubber price dropped over half. So then that means that's less money, that's less U.S. dollars coming in. And the government has nothing to do with that. It's the global market. You know, so the price of iron ore went down, the price of rubber went down, so therefore we're selling our things less, less money is coming in the country, therefore the rate is going to increase.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we must diversify, that's why we must focus on agriculture. Post-production in terms of cassava, rice, fisheries, we have to start exporting fish, things of that nature. You know, we have all this rubber and wood in this country. This is where the private sector must come in, furniture making. The government cannot do everything. You know, and that's the mentality that we have to change. Government should be there to provide the enabling environment.
Mm-hmm.
Let us as Liberians now focus on the private sector.
Take advantage.
And take advantage of it.
Okay, let me take the last batch. Good evening. Good evening. Welcome, what is your name?
Yeah, hello.
Welcome, what is your name? Your line, sir, go ahead.
I'm Joshua Keyworth.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm calling from Broad Street, Monrovia City.
Go ahead, Joshua.
Okay, what I have to say with everything. Let me congratulate the chairman here.
Okay.
And I have a very serious problem with LEC. More especially power
tech section. Hmm. You see that power tech section?
Power tech. Mm-hmm. And you see something with the equipment there are passing the meter. And if you hold them so you guys can help in the process of what's going to be developed. But I mean, they don't want to come and your office, both of office, they don't want to come. People are feeling the right.
So okay.
They will encourage the next method to be occurring. And secondly, I would like the council.
All right. Okay, my brother. Sorry, I have to hold you right there because we're also running with time too. So you address that, and then we can wrap up.
No, I mean everything he said is right. We need more people. We need to stop power theft. It's a gradual process. You know, everybody wants to see Liberia become a perfect country overnight. That's why I came back to Liberia to work. You know, I didn't come back to Liberia to say, "Oh, I want some money." I came back so all of us can work together to build the country. So if we see power theft, we have to be able to just call it in and hope that LEC, you know, because LEC now is also saying they are restrained in terms of capacity.
Mm.
They don't have enough engineers. We have to import engineers. And then even if we do, then they will say, and I'm not, but you know, we need better vehicles. We need overtime pay for people to be able, you know, so these are things that this process is not an overnight thing. is going to be gradual. It has to be generational. It's going to take time. We all, ourselves just have to be patient and stay the course. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, we have to fight power theft. Right now, it's at 33%. We have to be able to work to bring it in the 20s. Mm. Once we get it in 20, 25% in power theft, then we work towards bringing it down. Every country around the world faces power theft. The average is about 14 to 15%. We're double that. We have to be able to cut it down.
Well, Doc, we don't have much time to continue, so at this point, we'll now wrap up. And I just got one more question for you. Does the president really rest?
No, and that's why my eyes are red. I'm going to fall asleep while I'm on my way home. She does not rest. I don't know what. We always joke in the office, and I was saying it earlier, the old will kill the young. Because the president literally, it's a great learning experience for me. I'm happy to be back in country. I'm happy to be serving the country. We get in office at 8:15. We don't leave office till 9 o'clock every single day. That's the average day, and it's just nonstop work. You know, but again, you see development, you see the connections happening, you see roads being built, you see, schools being built, teachers are getting better. That's the reward. So we'll rest in 200 plus days when the new administration takes over. We'll rest. Some of us will join the private sector, and so that's it. So all of us will be here building the country. But either way, we're all here. We'll make Liberia better.
Well, thanks for coming. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Well, television viewers, on that note, I will come to the end of this evening's presentation of All Things Considered. Join me on Wednesday evening, 7 p.m. I'm going to be back. Hopefully, I'm thinking about being a politician. Well, somebody who wants to be president. Catch me on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. Until then, thanks to the entire team. I mean, the camera people and all those switches out of control. I'm Daniel Ankrah. Do have a wonderful time. And bye-bye. Up next is the news.
When there are issues to talk about, we talk about them. When there are matters to debate, we create the platform. When there are tough national decisions to make, we bring the stakeholders. All Things Considered, a television talk show designed to bring all that matters right to your television set. Never miss the conversation, this and every Monday and Wednesday from 7 to 7:50 p.m. on The Nation's Pride, the Liberia National Television, LNTV, with your host, Daniel Ankrah. All Things Considered, creating the platform for an inclusive dialogue.